Alright folks, the purpose of this video is to go over the basic oxy fuel setup for cutting. What I have here is I have an oxyacetylene setup. This is on a cart, so I've got a bottle of acetylene here. I have a barrier wall between it and a bottle of oxygen. Nothing is actually hooked up right now, except the torch itself is connected to the hoses and the regulator, but we're going to be hooking the regulators up. We've got a standard dark face shield number 5 on the striker, and we have a bottle of oxygen safe leak check. So the basic setup of this is outlined in a tag that's in the back of these carts. So if you open this up, in the shop find basically the setup procedure, lighting procedure, and also a tip chart, and I'll reference this later on. But those things are available and they should be with a torch. To get started, what we're gonna do is we're gonna hook up the regulators. Now, basically what I have here is I have a bottle of acetylene that's capped. This protective cap should always be on the bottle. The bottle should always be secured to the cart. In this case, I have a chain that's securing it. And I want to remove this cap by simply turning it off. This particular cap is one that I just put on, so I know it's going to come off relatively easily. But it simply threads off. We want to leave it on until it's secured and we're ready to use it. And the cap itself we can set off to the side. The oxygen cap, I'm going to grab a wrench. The oxygen cap is on quite tight. This particular cap actually has wrench flats on the top, so that you could actually use a wrench to help remove this if you needed to. I'm going to tell you that most of them don't. So in general, these should not be so tight that you need to use a wrench or a pry bar to get them off. You never want to stick anything through the holes in the cap in order to remove these, because you could damage the valve on the inside. My basic recommendation is that you take something like a dead blow hammer, something soft. If you're very careful, again, you can actually use the wrench, although this is not a hammer. But basically, you're gonna grab the cap with your hand and you're gonna turn it in the direction that it wants to go. And then not hitting the threads, but hitting the cap body very lightly. We're not beating on this, this is just light. I'm gonna actively try to rotate it, so I've got pressure on this, and maybe you can't see that in the camera, but I am trying to turn it. I'm just gonna tap this lightly. And there it goes. So it'll start to thread off. You don't have to pound on it, and you shouldn't pound on it. If you have to hit it harder than that, than a light tap, you definitely want to use a non-marring hammer or a dead blow hammer. A rubber mallet might work, but that slight jarring action, that impact, a lot of times you'll actually see rust come out of here, like little poofs of rust clouds, and that capture didn't come free. If it squeaks and squawks, that's just the way it is. Again, once that cap has been removed, we can set it off to the side. Your oxygen bottle and your acetylene bottle need to be cleared, meaning that we want to make sure that there's no contaminants inside of this valve. So I'm going to stand away from the valve with the valve facing opposite me. In this case, I'm going to go to the acetylene side, reach over, and I'm going to clear this valve. I'm just going to crack it, let a small amount of gas escape. So again, over here in a safe direction, I'm going to put on my safety glasses. Just a little bit, okay? Now this is not a full bottle, so we didn't get a big blast of air, but again, I want to make sure there's no debris in there. Likewise, I want to do the same thing. I want to make sure that my acetylene is clear. And again, I'm just going to open this valve really quickly and let just a tiny, tiny amount of gas escape. Acetylene is obviously the fuel gas. The oxygen is an oxygen oxygenator, so to speak. Doesn't sound right, but we're going to roll with it for the purpose of this video. It's an oxidizer, oxygenator. I don't even know where that came from. It's an oxidizer. So basically, oxygen doesn't burn, but it makes anything that does burn, burn like crazy. Acetylene burns, okay? Now you may have propylene, you may have propane, you may have MAP, you may have any number of fuel gases. The procedure for doing this is exactly the same, okay? The next step is to connect the regulators. Since I'm on the acetylene side, I'm gonna start with the acetylene regulator. In this case, this was removed just for demonstration purposes. The regulator itself is already connected to the hose. This was an active setup. I disconnected it for the purposes of this video. The acetylene regulator and the oxygen regulator are different. If you get a good close-up view, and I know that we can't with this camera, but the actual regulators themselves, the end connections, are not the same. So we will not connect to the wrong bottle. Additionally, on the acetylene, in most cases, on the hose parts, and this is true for all the fuel gases, in most cases, this is a left-handed thread. Instead of turning right to tighten, it turns left to tighten. And that's indicated by small notches that are found in this thread connection. The acetylene regulator itself needs to be inspected to make sure it's in good working order. And this is connected to a hose, but I'll treat it as if it wasn't. I want to make sure that this is backed out, that it's not in where it's tight. This is threaded almost completely in before it begins to feel any resistance. But again, I need to back this out. I want to make sure the valves are zeroed out, there's no signs of physical damage, and that this is clean. I want to make sure that no dirt, grease, oil, or contaminants ever get on a regulator. Now, in all reality, that is most dangerous on the oxygen bottle, but again, habits are habit forming, so if you get in the habit of not allowing any oils, greases, or other forms of contamination that would contain hydrocarbons to get on these surfaces, then that's your best bet. Essentially, what will happen is on an oxygen cylinder, if there's any oil or grease in there, when the high pressure oxygen hits it, the heat of compression, which is how a diesel engine works, will spontaneously combust the oil. Of course, there's oxygen coming into it, so there's an ample supply of oxygen required to burn, and the resulting detonation can take out the regulator and the bottle and the entire room. So it's a very, very dangerous situation. In this particular case, I've already checked these prior to coming on camera. I disassembled these before making the video, so I know that they're clear. If there's any question as to whether a regulator is a proper working order, you don't fix it. I send this off to Matheson, Main Oxy, any one of those companies, a professional, I guess is the short version. They will repair this, they will service this. I don't touch this, okay? So this particular regulator and bottle setup, even though it's acetylene, on the regulator side does not have a left-handed thread, so I'm gonna simply tighten this on. I'm gonna insert it in, and then I'm gonna tighten this nut up. Now the nut may or may not go on easily by hand. It should thread almost all the way in. So I'm turning that as I'm talking. And when I get this all the way in, and if you have to, give a little wiggle with your hand on the regulator to make sure that it's kind of mechanically centered. Once this is snug, I'm then going to take a wrench. In this case, I'm using a large adjustable wrench because I don't have an actual box wrench that's large enough size. I want to adjust this to make sure that it fits the brass correctly so I don't damage the outside of the nut. And then I'm going to snug this up. I'm going to hold the regulator from turning as I do it because it will want to rotate. And the question always that's asked is, you know, how tight does it need to be? Well, the answer is it needs to be tight enough that it doesn't leak, but not so tight that it can have a damaged surface and you stop it from leaking by over tightening. That's a long answer. Make it snug. Give it maybe just a tiny bit more. I don't have a torque, you know, for this, but ultimately, if you have to really get on it hard, there's probably something else that's wrong. If you ever notice damage to the regulator, that damage to the regulator will just imprint into the valve, and you'll actually destroy the valve in the same process. Ultimately, we're going to verify whether it leaks or not with a leak check, and we'll get to that in a few minutes. I'm going to come around to the oxygen side, do the same thing. On the oxygen side, again, the regulator itself needs to be inspected. We need to make sure that we don't touch this with dirt, grease, or oil. Inside here, there is a filter. That filter looks like a small compressed copper itty bitty teeny little spheres, okay? If that's not in there, don't use it. I'm just telling you from my own personal belief is that if you get a regulator that does not have that filter, there's a much larger chance of a particle passing through, getting into the inside and blocking this from working correctly, which would put full manifold pressure, full bottle pressure, which is upwards of 2,800 pounds per square inch, on a portion of this that's not designed to take that much pressure, okay? So we won't talk about regulator design and engineering today, but we will say simply that make sure that the filter that's supposed to be in place is in place. We've already checked this to make sure it's clear. I'm gonna insert this in, and I'm gonna tighten this up. As before, I'm going to use my wrench and I'm going to make this snug. I'm going to prevent this from rotating with my hand. This should not have to be excessively tight. I'll give it a quick pull. The rest of the setup in this particular case, I've already checked. I'm not going to cover setting the torches up today, but suffice it to say that there are connections on the torch, there are connections on the other end of the hose. You may have an intermediate hose connection, you may have two short lengths of hose that are connected with a splice. You want to make sure all those connections are secure and that they're all snug. Okay. The torch itself, I will inspect for proper use. I'll make sure that the valves on the torch are in the closed position before I start. In this case, they are. Again, these don't need to be tight at all. They just need to be snug. These are precision machine brass valves, so they don't have to be over-tightened. I want to make sure that the lever, in this case, it's a cutting torch, is functional, that it actually springs back the way it's supposed to. And I want to make sure that the connections on the end of the torch, the tip, the nut, everything is tight. Again, this torch was in service, so it's already been checked out for the purposes of this video. My next step is going to be to check for leaks. Okay? Once the regulators are installed, they've been inspected, I know that they work, I know that they're zeroed out, I want to go ahead and check the system for leaks. Now, I'm again going to stand away from the regulator when I turn these on. If this is going to explode, I don't want to be in front of it. So I'm going to step back behind it from the opposite side. The regulator wants to either blow apart this way or this way, so I'm going to stand clear. I'm going to put on my safety glasses and I'm going to crack this valve. I'm going to open this valve slowly. Okay. Now, when I open this valve up, and again, I can feel it, the seal kind of break, and I'm just going to open it real slow, let that pressure come up. Okay? I don't have to open this valve quickly. I don't want to open it quickly. I do want to open it all the way. So your high pressure cylinder valves are designed to be open 100%. They're either all the way open or all the way closed. On my fuel gas, I'm going to throttle this valve. I'm not going to open it 100%. And the reasoning for this is that I can't consume the fuel at the rate that it would be allowed to flow at 100%. With acetylene in particular, we can only take approximately 1/7 of the tank out per hour. It's a very slow withdrawal. Acetylene cylinders themselves are filled with a chalky substance. It's like a sponge, which then in turn is filled with acetone, and then in turn is filled with acetylene gas. So think of it as the CO2 in your Coca-Cola. Okay, the gas is actually in a liquid in that case, and it percolates out. So opening the valve wide open won't make any difference. But I am going to open it again slowly. I'm going to stand clear of it, and I'm going to open it. Now this is not a high pressure cylinder, but I still want to be respectful of it, especially the first time I hooked it up. So once that's open and I verify that I have pressure, this is almost full. In fact, it is full. I'd say it's just over 250 PSI. The oxygen cylinder is only at about 400 PSI. So again, this is not very full at all. What I'm going to do basically is I know that this is on, and I'm going to simply close the valve now that I know that it didn't blow up, and I'm going to open it. You can open it a half a turn or basically 1.5 turns. My general rule of thumb is once the valve actually kind of breaks free, you can feel the valve kind of come loose, I just give it one good hard twist with my hand. And that way, if there was ever a problem and I had to shut this down, one good hard twist with my hand and it's off. Okay, so that's how we would shut the fuel down. In order to check for leaks, initially I want to check the connection that I disconnected. So I'm not going to turn this adjustment to let gas into this regulator beyond the initial stage. Okay, now I'm going to check this for leaks. I have an oxygen safe leak check. Okay, this needs to be O2 safe. Don't use Dawn dish detergent and water. It's not safe. It's got hydrocarbons in it. On the oxygen side, it could cause an explosion. Acetylene has an odor to it. That odor is added at the factory. Acetylene is a man-made gas. They add an odor. It's very pungent. It smells like rotten eggs. If you have an acetylene leak, you may smell it. But again, don't count on your sense of smell. Use the leak check. So again, I'm simply going to spray this down. You're not going to hurt these parts by having them exposed. Now, on the acetylene tank, I have a leak. I can see it right now. On the oxygen side, I don't have anything. So I'm going to grab the camera. We're going to take a look at this leak on the acetylene side. You have bubbles forming. See if I can get this to focus. So that is a leak. Okay, I have a leak detector on there, and I have a leak. So we are absolutely, positively not going to put this bottle into service, knowing that we're leaking explosive acetylene gas out into the space. All right. So off camera, because I didn't know how long this would take, or what I was really getting myself into, this is wide open. We have pressure on the system. And again, I'm going to spray it back down with my leak check. And I'm going to sit back and watch. Now, again, I have no bubbles, so I have no leak. There are bubbles present, and that's not to be confused. If I take the leak check and simply spray it virtually anywhere, because it is coming out in an aerosol form, there are bubbles present. That's because it's, you know, coming out of the nozzle under high pressure and atomizing. So the bubbles need to be moving, folks. So don't worry if there's a bubble. But there's no bubble growth, okay? So we have now checked that out. Additionally, I've hosed down the rest of the setup, okay? So we wanna make sure that none of the other connections have any leaks. So you're not gonna hurt anything by getting the torch wet or anything else wet. So you wanna absolutely make sure that we have no leaks. The next step in this process is going to be to set our pressures. We've set the machine up, we've verified that we don't have leaks. And what I have off here is I have the torch chart. The torch chart can be a little bit confusing, so let's take a peek at it. I'm going to come around the back of the camera and see if we can't look at this. This is a typical tip chart right here. This tip chart is from Victor. This is available online. Please note that this is for a particular cutting tip series, okay? So we're using the 1-101 tip series. There's a lot of material on this chart that is not necessarily information that we need. As an example, cutting oxygen pressure, that column is really what we want. The preheat oxygen pressure is not needed. That is for a multi-line machine torch. Additionally, acetylene pressure is another line that we actually need, but we're probably not concerned with the speed in inches per minute if we're traveling by hand. We have to adjust that, you know, kind of by eye. The kerf width is simply how wide the cut is, just for reference, and that's if the tip's in perfect condition. And then the other information is metal thickness and the tip size. So if we're going to be cutting, for example, 3/4 inch thick material, we would want a number one tip. We would set the oxygen regulators to between 35 and 40 psi, and we would skip over and set the acetylene pressure anywhere from 3 to 6 psi. Okay, so you always want to consult a tip chart before you go and set your pressures. Now, here in the school, the tip chart is always going to be right to the back of the torches. There's also a torch lighting procedure, okay? Essentially, what we have on this torch lighting procedure is one side we have the initial setup and safety checks. So we're going to go through that. Inspect your equipment, torches and hoses for damage. We did that. We want to verify valves on torches are closed. Again, that has been done. We want to install the correct tip per the size chart. We'll take a look at that before we do our cutting, but we will check the size chart. My intention is to cut 3/4 inch material. Again, I want a number one tip. Verify the regulator adjusting screws are backed out. Again, they are right now. They're not tight. I have zero pressure on these gauges. That's what we're looking for. And then open both the oxygen and acetylene cylinder valves slowly. So again, that has been done in the process of checking for leaks. So the acetylene valve is open all the way because I was just doing a leak check. I wanted to verify that. So I'm going to go back and open this half to 1.5 turns. Basically one good wrist movement once the valve breaks. So we're going to use the tip chart when we set our gas pressure. We're going to press the oxygen level to fine-tune the regulator. As we adjust this, we want to make sure that that's correct. We're going to open the acetylene torch about 0.5 turn. Make sure the gas is flowing. Double check the pressure while it's flowing. And all of your pressures on your regulators, when we get to that point in the video where we set those, should be while the gas is flowing. And then finally, we're going to go ahead and light the torch if, in fact, we're ready to strike an arc. The process is here, okay, both setup and shutdown. So right now, we're ready to go ahead and light this torch. I've got to get my safety gear on. We're going to check the tip size. We're going to get some material out, reposition the camera. We're going to go ahead and light this thing up. All right, folks, the tip size that I want, I'm going to cut some 3/4 inch material, is a number one tip. The tip size that's on this right now is a number zero. So this is for cutting material that's thinner than 3/4 of an inch. The tips are numbered. Sorry for the noise. The tips are actually numbered on the side of the tip. I'm going to bring this around for the camera so we can see this. Okay. Getting the camera to focus will be a challenge. So I have 1-1-101. The first number is the tip size. The 1-101 is the tip series. It's the type of torch that this tip fits, okay? The tip itself should be inspected. This one's been used, so it's a little dirty on the end, but it's a good serviceable condition. The biggest thing really is this end of the tip. We want to make sure that these beveled areas here and here, these machine surfaces, are free from burrs, okay? If we had a damaged surface, we could tighten this down to the point where it doesn't leak, but we would simply imprint the damage into the tip, into the torch. The tip is a relatively inexpensive part. The torch is several hundred dollars. So again, it shouldn't take a lot of pressure to get this to fit. I don't want to drop this on the floor, even though it's not expensive, it's not cheap. but relative to the torch. So I'm gonna leave it in the case. I'm gonna set this off to the side. The torch itself, right now, has no gas flowing to it because I have not opened the regulators yet. The torch is connected and the valve is open on the bottle, but I have not put any pressure here. So while there's 400 pounds per square inch on the bottle side of the regulator, there's nothing on the opposite side. In order to remove this, again, I'm going to use a large wrench. I can put the wrench on and get it adjusted to where it fits. This shouldn't be all that tight, but I can actually put the wrench on and use the torch kind of to press. And again, I can release it that way, okay? When you tighten it back up, again, if I just turn it so it's aimed now towards me, again, I can give it a squeeze and I can tighten it back up. So this is my preferred method. Aim it away, get it adjusted so it's at a slight angle, and then I can squeeze. This does not need to be tight, folks, okay? Just snug, maybe a little beyond. As I thread this off, keep in mind that I don't want to drop the tip that's in there as well because it's still usable. This tip is 0-1-101. I have the containers numbered so that they're easy to find. So please don't put this in the wrong container. I'm going to set this off to the side in a safe place. And then I will retrieve the correct container from the shop when I put this back together. Right now I'm going to remove the tip. Again, set the container down. And with the torch upright, I'm going to carefully place the tip inside. And then I'm going to put the nut on. Without the nut completely tightened, if I rotate the tip, it should feel solid. It shouldn't rock at all, okay? It might turn, but it shouldn't rock. Rocking would indicate that something is wrong. So again, I'm gonna snug this down, and then I'm gonna give this a little bit of a snug tighten. Now, I had already checked this setup before, but I checked it before I determined what I was gonna cut, so I'm gonna pressurize the system and I'm going to leak check this area right here to make sure I don't have a leak in the tip where I did the reinstall. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to set these pressures. I'm going to bring the camera in closer so we can do that. All right, on the oxygen side, the tip chart told me that I wanted 35 to 40 pounds per square inch. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn this valve until this starts to rise. Now note that the inside gauge is PSI. This one is in red. And the outside gauge, let me see if I can zoom in a little bit, get this a little bit more visible. The outside is kilopascals, which probably doesn't mean anything to you. Or in this case, I guess it's bars, okay? Typically our tip chart in the United States is in pounds per square inch. So you have to make sure we're looking at the right scale. Every regulator is different. So again, you have to be familiar with how they're set up. The first major number that's indicated in this case is 30. The next is 60. So logic would dictate that the first long line is 10. The next long line underneath where the black needle is 20. You have 30, that would be 40, 50, 60. So again, you have to be able to interpret what those mean. What I want is 35 to 40 PSI, and I'll set this on roughly 35 PSI. Now that does not indicate that the torch is perfectly adjusted. In fact, I wouldn't spend too much effort getting this perfect. In fact, what happens if we screwed up and we went a little too high? Well, this only lets the gas through one way. So by backing this down, that needle's not going to move. In order for the needle to move, gas has to escape the system. So if you go a little too high, don't worry, it's not a big deal. The next step will take care of it. In the next step, I'm going to take the torch, and I have, again, the torch right here. I'm going to back this video out a little bit. And I'm actually going to press the lever, okay, to let the oxygen flow while I adjust the pressure. So you'll hear the oxygen going. I'm actually allowing oxygen to pass through the torch. While I do that, I can adjust this up or down, because now gas is allowed to escape the system. So with the oxygen flowing, I'm going to set this on 35 psi. Okay, it's important that the volume of oxygen, the flow rate, be set while we're actually making our adjustment. You may notice in some instances that the pressure is a little bit higher. Right now it appears to be almost 40, but when the oxygen is flowing, again, that's where we're fine-tuning it. So I'm gonna adjust it right there, okay? We're gonna do the same thing on the acetylene side. So let's readjust. All right, on the acetylene side, we wanted 4 to 6 psi. I think as a general rule, what you'll discover is right around 5 pounds per square inch is adequate for most cutting with acetylene from, say, 1/4 inch up to about 1 inch thick. But again, refer to your tip chart. As I turn this in, this pressure will again rise. I know that my torch is currently off, so there it starts to go. So again, it went up a little higher than I wanted. If I back this off, nothing's gonna happen because the gas cannot escape the system. So again, I come in and I open my acetylene valve. Again, I'm just gonna lightly open this valve in the torch. I'll do that off camera. And I have now to adjust that to roughly 5 pounds per square inch. The valve is open about half a turn, and there I have 5 PSI. When I close the valve on the torch, the pressure may rise, but again, while the gas is flowing, I'm gonna open it right now off camera. Now I have the correct flow rate, and that's what I'm concerned about, is making sure that the flow is adjusted while it's actually cutting. It needs to be the correct pressure. So now I have those set. As I mentioned a minute ago, because I changed the tip out, I wanna make this sure there's no leaks here. So I'm going to allow the oxygen to flow through, and I'm going to check this. In this case, I'm simply going to open the preheat valve, and I'm going to hose this down the leak check. I want to make sure that there is no leaks. I'm going to put this up on both sides of the tip. And again, I'm not concerned about bubbles per se. I'm concerned about bubble growth. Okay. If the bubbles are growing, then that is a problem. Okay. So there it is off. Again, I will also check with the fuel gas on, and I will do the same thing. Now I have ventilation running off to the side, which you can't see or hear. So again, I have no leaks. So I'm going to close this out. I'm going to allow the room to vent for a minute. Clear any gas that may be in here. Acetylene will rise, other fuel gases will fall. And then we're gonna set up some material, and we're gonna actually light the torch. All right, folks, right now the main ventilation is on. I've got my personal protective equipment. I've got my safety glasses on. I've got my face shield. This is a number 5 shade, so I can use this for torch cutting. I have leak checked my torch, and I'm ready to strike an arc. Keep in mind that right now, because I have the valves on, there is actually acetylene in this hose, and there is oxygen in this hose. But if you go to set up quickly with a torch that you've used prior, maybe you shut it down for lunch, drain the gas out, when you come back on, there may be air in the hose, so it may not light immediately. So I'm just going to simply open the acetylene valve with a 1/4 turn, and I'm going to reach up with my striker and I'm going to strike. The only thing I ever want to use to strike the torch is the striker. Make sure you have gloves on, other protective equipment, and again, make sure that what you're doing is in a well-ventilated area. Now, I'm going to turn this down. I have soot coming off of this. Hopefully the camera picks this up. And what I want to do essentially is open this valve up until I get a nice yellow flame and the soot goes away, okay? I'm relying on the settings on the machine to make sure the flame is right. I shouldn't really have to do a lot of fine tuning here. In theory, I should be able to open this valve right up and the flow there is correct for what I'm touching. So once that's up, I'm going to open my oxygen slowly. And then I'm going to tune this in. I want to adjust for a neutral flame. That's going to be difficult to show in this clip. But essentially here, I have too much acetylene. And I have an outer flame that will shrink in smaller and smaller to the inner flame. When those two are even, I have what's called a neutral flame that I'm ready to cut. I'm going to press the lever. Make sure I'm getting a good flow through. I have a nice clean, what I call a stinger, the little line to the middle of the fork to make sure that this is cutting clear. But right now it looks pretty good. So I'm going to go down and I'm going to make a cut. Again, once I've made my cut, I'm going to shut this down in the reverse order. Oxygen first, acetylene last. If you do it in the wrong, you get a loud pop. That's a flashback, and again, we want to avoid that. So you turn on the fuel first, because oxygen, remember, doesn't burn. It just helps things burn. And we turn the oxygen off first, so that we don't have the higher pressure oxygen trying to backfeed into the acetylene components. Now that this is actually shut down, we'll go through the full shutdown procedure and we'll review the entire thing. We'll cover how to cut in another video. So for the purposes of the video and sanity's sake, I've turned the main ventilation off. In the process of shutting down, the first thing we want to do is shut down the valves. The next thing we're going to do is basically shut down the tanks. It doesn't matter which one you turn off first, but we need to turn them both off. We're going to turn the tank itself off. Okay, we're not going to touch the regulators at this point. So let's take a look. I'm going to just go handheld. We'll finish this up. Here we go. All right, so right now, I've actually gone through, closed this valve. And they don't need to be torqued down to 100 foot-pounds, but we want to make sure they're shut. On the other end, and it doesn't matter what the order is, essentially what we have to do is we have to stop the gas from coming out of the tank, and then we have to let the gas that's still trapped from here on out of the hose. So again, we're going to turn this valve off. Nothing's going to happen, folks. We're not going to see the needles move. Okay, this is off. So right now, gas is in the tank. It is trapped between here and the other end of the torch. I'm going to do the same thing on the acetylene side. I'm going to turn this valve off. It shouldn't take much to shut it off. So again, the gas can no longer come out of the main tank, but there is still gas. As you can see, there is still pressure throughout the system. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to vent this off. I'm going to open this valve, the oxygen valve, or I could squeeze the lever, and I'm going to vent this. I'm going to do the same thing with the acetylene side. But I'm going to do it over here so you can see the result. So, oxygen. I'm going to open the oxygen valve on the torch. Here we go. Press the lever. Oxygen is escaping and the pressure is dropping. So right now, I've released all the pressure from the system on the oxygen side. Okay. I'm going to do the same thing on the acetylene side. Again, off to the side where you can't see it, but I have the torch right over here. I'm going to open this valve. Now I am letting a little acetylene into the space, but I have ventilation, the door is open, I'll let this air out. And in general, again, this is a small amount of gas, but that doesn't mean we don't want to be cautious with it. All right, so we want to have a well-ventilated work area. Again, opening the valve now, and again, the pressure drops pretty quickly on the primary side. On the secondary side, give her a little tap, you know, and the needle is all the way down. So that is empty, okay? At this stage of the game, we are not ready to coil up and put away, because what we have is a situation where the next person comes around, opens this valve, pressurized gas goes through here. This will read the tank pressure side. And then because this is still turned in, it will let gas flow through all the way to the other end of the torch. And we don't know if the next guy coming along has checked these valves, or for all we know, there's not even a torch hooked up that could have been taken off for service, maintenance, or repair. So what we have to do as a last step is we have to back this out. Now, this is hard to demonstrate on camera because, again, it's by feel, but as I turn this, right there, they got easy to turn. All of a sudden, it just got easy. I don't have to thread this all the way out, folks. I don't want to have a mountain of thread showing. I don't want you to remove this. We just want to back it out until all of a sudden it starts to turn freely. And at that point, when I open the main tank, okay, and if I were to open this valve, pressure would be on this side because it's reading what's in the tank, but there would be nothing here because this regulator is not allowing the gas to go through into the hose. The same thing on the acetylene side. Again, if I don't back this valve out right here, someone opens the tank will pressurize this side, it'll show how much is in the tank, and because this is twisted in, this will show pressure and gas will immediately start leaking down through the hose. If there's no torch on the other end, that would be a very dangerous situation. So again, we're gonna back this out until all of a sudden it starts to feel easy. And right there, it's loose. That's it. It does not have to be threaded all the way out. So at this stage of the game, we will be ready to coil up our hose, put everything away nice and neat, and clean up our mess.